gentlemen. Welcome to Café Scientifique for our second of this summer series. It's great to have everybody here, and your attendance and your support for this lab is truly amazing, and thank you very much indeed. My name's Graham Chenild. I'm the executive director here. It's great. I'm privileged to be introducing Cindy Heil, and I'm going to say a few more words about Cindy in a moment. But just so that you know how you can keep in touch with the events at Bigelow, we're on Facebook and Twitter. You can use all those social media tools that you've become familiar with to track the events that is taking place. And in particular, on Friday this week, we have an open house where there's the opportunity to come in and see some demonstrations and talk with scientists and sort of have an interactive day starting at 10 a.m. in the morning. So everyone is most welcome to come and attend that. Tonight's talk is by Cindy Heil. As you can see, she's going to get you up close and personal with algae. Some of it may be a little concerning to you, but Cindy is really an authority on this subject, and I encourage you to use the time to ask questions of her. And I think Cindy doesn't mind if you interrupt if she's saying something that's not quite clear to you. Next week in the series of Café Scientifique, we have Mike Lomas presenting on how the Arctic food web systems are working. So he'll bring a rather different perspective and move us away from waters in coastal Maine and I guess Florida. We're going to talk a little about Florida. So we'll be going on to the Arctic next week. So Cindy joined us back in November of 2010. She has her bachelor's degree from Purdue University and a master's from University of South Florida. She then went on to graduate school of oceanography at Rhode Island in 1996, all the time making harmful algae her passion and study subject. At that point, Cindy moved abroad. She went off to Australia and worked in Brisbane, and there she developed some of the new methods of looking at water quality and how those were changing as Australia was becoming very concerned about these algal issues that Cindy will be talking about. She returned to Florida from 1998 and working with the Fish and Wildlife Research Institute there and then with the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission. She's overseeing large groups of scientists working on the sorts of problems and issues she'll mention tonight. So it's great to have actually a world-renowned expert in this field to present to you, and I'm going to hand over to Cindy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Graham, for that introduction. Welcome to Bigelow. It's a beautiful Tuesday night, and thank you very much for coming to hear me talk on such a beautiful night. I'm going to talk about nasty, toxic things. A little bit of a contrast to the beautiful night. Feel free to interrupt me at any time if you have questions. Scientists tend to slip into jargon. I try not to, but I'm a scientist, I do it. If you have a question about something I'm talking about, just raise your hand or yell out, "Hey, Cindy," that's fine. Or a question about some of the topics I'm talking about. I will try not to scare you too much, but I'm going to tell you a little bit about some of the current research and current concerns about harmful algae. So, do toxic algal blooms affect you? Let's see. The short answer, if you live in Maine, they do, but not so much this year. This NOAA every year puts out a bulletin for Maine saying, you're going to get a bad red tide, you're going to get, not so bad. This year, light red tide. In fact, I believe DMR was opening up their shellfish beds last week. So that's a very light year for red tide. In fact, most of you are probably not even aware that we've had a red tide this year. And that's a good thing. That means you're safe to eat the seafood, or you're safe to drink the water, and life is good. Now, conversely, if you live in Florida, not so much. You know when you make the national news with the governor declaring a state of algal emergency that you've got problems, big problems. This was last week in Florida, and I'm bringing Florida up because I have a lot of experience with it, And there are a lot of Maine residents that actually come to Maine in the winter, go to Florida in the summer. And a lot of people go on vacations. This is a freshwater cyanobloom, cyanobacterial bloom, which we consider a harmful algal bloom in Florida. That's probably a picture of the scum from here to here, looking at the surface of the water. And you can see the governor is the first state of emergency for an algal bloom in Florida. Usually they don't like to talk about algal blooms in Florida because it hurts tourism. But when it's this bad, you know it's bad. These are some pictures, so I wanted to kind of emphasize to you guys how bad it actually is down there right now. And I'm kind of thankful that I'm not managing this crisis at the moment. This is a type of algal bloom I'm going to talk about. It's not really algae. It's called the cyanobacterial bloom, or a cyanohab. It's a more primitive type of microorganism in the ocean and in freshwater systems. This is how bad it is. That's a picture looking at Lake Okeechobee, the big diked above-ground freshwater lake in South Florida that receives a lot of nutrient input from the sugar industry. Perfect conditions for a cyanohab, high light, high temperature, lots of nutrients, shallow system. The problem is this particular system is diked lake above ground, and the dikes are not very sturdy. So the Army Corps every year releases water to the two rivers that flow out of it, St. Lucie River and the Coosahatchee. They happened to do this year when there was an algal bloom. So you have kind of apocalyptic conditions for an algal bloom in Florida, and that's why they're having problems. You can see, it's so thick around this marina. People leave, they don't want to smell it. It's on the beaches, it's this thick scum at the surface. So algal blooms, it gets in that surface and it starts to rot and decay, and the smell is horrible, not just the water itself. And it is a health risk. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about it later. So yes, it's bad, and you see it on the news. So do toxic algal blooms affect you? I have a box that I'm supposed to stand in for the live feed, and I've already stepped out of it. So if I wander this way, just go this way, okay? So do toxic algal blooms affect you? Well, that depends on a whole lot of factors. It depends on where you are, what's blooming where you are, how close are you to what's blooming, what are you doing, what are you eating, and are you doing it near or in the bloom water? So there's a whole variety of qualifiers to this. The two things that, is that feedback on me? I hope not. Well, the two types of blooms or habs I'm going to talk to you about tonight are Maine red tides, Maine habs, and freshwater cyanohabs. And this is kind of the leading edge of hab research at the moment, is these freshwater blooms. Why are we concerned about these freshwater blooms? And my 7-year-old said, "Well, what's a cyanohab?" And I said, "See that green stuff? He's all pond scum." I'm like, yeah. So a freshwater cyanohab, somebody asks you what they are, it's pond scum, basically. The green stuff in freshwater. Why is it a concern? Drinking water. We pull a lot of our drinking water from these freshwater systems. If you're pulling drinking water with a cyano bloom, you're probably pulling drinking water with toxins. Links with neurological diseases. And this is where the research is cutting edge. It's not definitive, but it is rather frightening. And also economic impacts. That Florida bloom, you make the national news, you're going to have an economic impact. Tourists don't want to go to Florida right now. South Florida, you don't want to go to that bloom. What is a hab?
Thank you.
The basics. I got a little ahead of myself. What is a hab? We used to call these red tides, but they're not red, they have nothing to do with tides. Scientists now prefer to use the word hab, and that's short for harmful algal bloom. When I say cyanohab, that means a cyanobacterial harmful algal bloom, and that's kind of a, cyanobacteria aren't algae, but we use the terms anyway. So when I say hab, it's a red tide, basically. So what is a hab? It is a bloom of higher than normal concentration of microscopic algae that cause harm. And they can do this in a variety of ways. They can have toxins. They can have high biomass. Simply, you get so many cells that it affects the oxygen in the water. You hear about the dead zone off the Mississippi River every year. That's considered a hab. It's not toxic, but it blooms to such density that it essentially uses all the oxygen and you produce an anoxic dead zone. But it is considered a hab. Or physical damage. Some of these species have spines. If a salmon in aquaculture is actually consuming these or exposed to them, it can rip the gills apart. Just So there's a variety of mechanisms. Who can be harmed? Humans. And this can be done in a variety of ways. Ingestion, you eat shellfish that have consumed HAB, toxins. You can actually inhale it, and I'll talk to that. That's an issue in Florida right now. It's an issue with cyanohabs I'll talk about. And sometimes just contact. Some of these freshwater pond scum, if you contact it, can cause dermatitis. You can be allergic to it in terms of your skin. Who's harmed? Wildlife too. You think of marine wildlife, manatees, whales, dolphins, fish, but also cyanohabs domestic and wild animals that drink water from these systems. Australia has a lot of these cyanohabs, and they have a lot of mortality of stock cattle that consume these, dogs, that sort of thing. And it's not a who, but a what. Economies are harmed. Some of the estimates are one bloom in Florida can cause $50 million in damage. I can guarantee you that bloom they're having right now is having a huge economic impact on tourism in Florida. Nobody wants to go to Florida when it's scummy and green. The other basics I want you to consider, all HABs are not created equal. So you'll hear the term red tide, and you'll be in Maine, red tide in Florida, red tide on the West Coast, red tide in Australia. It's not necessarily the same thing. You have to know where you are. A Maine red tide is not equal to a Florida red tide. It's not equal to a cyano. They're different organisms. The Maine red tide, that's Alexandrium up there, two cells. The Florida red tide, Karenia brevis, a single cell. And then four different examples of cyanohab, a prokaryotic type of bloom. They have different toxins. And you can barely see them, I apologize, but I put the structure up there for some of these. And they have just different distributions too. I put at the bottom the distributions of these three types of HABs. So when you go out and you hear the term red tide, ask what species it is, ask whether it's local, ask whether they're talking about going to Florida for spring break and inhaling red tide at the beach. That's going to be different than up here. You're never going to inhale a rain red tide, I'll tell you. But if you get a bad clam, you can spend a bad weekend. So different impacts. Here in Maine. People are familiar. How many are familiar with Alexandrian blooms? Nobody? One or two? I see two little hands back there from people that I know. One of which I hope is my intern that is researching Alexandrian. I see you back there. Well, this is a basic primer on Maine red tide. What you need to know. That's the organism at the top. That's a vegetative cell. In the water, if you took a sample of water during a red tide, that's what you'd see in the water. It's happy, it's dividing, that's actually two cells. This particular species has cysts, and that's very important to its life cycle. Cyst is kind of a seed stage for these algae. And at the end of a bloom, when it's nutrient limited or light limited or being grazed, it'll produce these cysts. They're heavy, they sink to the sediment, and that's where they stay. You can core through half a foot of sediment, actually map the distribution of these cysts. Every year then, blooms initiate. We don't have a bloom in the winter. The blooms initiate when the light levels start coming up in the spring and the temperature starts coming up, and these cysts respond. And they excyst, they hatch, and they go up into the water column, and if, oops, sorry, am I echoing? Let's see, maybe if I move it better.
Yes.
Okay. Raise your hand and tell me if I'm doing that. Anyway, a happy cell, happy existed cell, will grow. If it gets nutrients from the local systems, it'll start dividing and blooming. And you'll get more and more of these cells. I mentioned that NOAA predicts every year whether a Maine red tide is going to be not bad, medium, or really bad. How they do that is these cysts. And what they do every year is they go on research boats and take sediment cores, and I've got a picture of one of their maps here. You can see, this is the Bay of Fundy down to Cape Cod. And where you see the red, those are cyst beds. Those are very high concentrations of cysts. And what they know is there's two beds in our system, Casco Bay and the Bay of Fundy. And every spring, these two beds, the cells exist, they go into the water column, and they start forming blooms. Now you have to know a little bit about oceanography to know about red tides, because this is, oops, the wrong pointer. A map, and I apologize, it's a little small, of the currents. And there's something about the main coastal current right there. I wish it was a little bigger. But that's a coastal current that runs from the Bay of Fundy, south along the coast, down to Cape Cod here, and then goes out to George's Bank here. So what you have every spring, two cyst beds, cells existing in the water. At the same time, you have rivers coming in with nutrients, and this current radiates down the coast. And we know this is true, they've modeled it, and also, it's kind of interesting, you can follow toxicity down the coast. It becomes toxic up here first, and then it moves down the coast, and sometimes all the way down to Cape Cod. And this species is actually spreading south, so they've got toxicity down into Rhode Island and along the Connecticut shore now too, where they never did before. Prior to 1972, Maine didn't have riptides, believe it or not. You know what happened? There was a very bad storm that came down, a nor'easter, that brought a population from the Bay of Fundy down to Maine. And what happened is that bloom existed, produced this, dropped to the bottom, and it essentially seeded Maine in 1972. And ever after that, Maine has gotten riptides every year. So, that's Maine riptides. The good thing about Maine red tides is it's very well monitored. The state does a phenomenal job, and right now they're doing it in conjunction with Bigelow. Seafood and water is tested, and areas are close to harvesting if the toxins or the cells are present. And what you can do is actually go to a website. You can call Maine DMR or go to a website and check whether the area around you is open or closed for shell fishing. Right now here at Bigelow, we're collaborating with DMR for some of this toxin testing. We have an agreement with them. And we're also, this is quite an accomplishment coming from an FDA approved lab in Florida. We are approved by the FDA for the new methods of analytical analysis for this toxin. Bigelow is the only lab in the US that is currently approved for this. The old way of testing for toxins is something called a mouse assay. And I won't tell you details, because it's what you think it is. I am responsible for a lot of mice mortality in my career. It's for a whole variety of reasons, it's better to go to an instrumental approach. Bigelow is the only FDA certified lab to do this. And why it's important? Economically, they do not accept the mouse assay, but they do accept this instrumentation. So if you want to ship shellfish out of Maine, you can get it certified, not certified, but analyzed at Bigelow. And Europe will accept those test results, or they would not accept a mouse assay. So this is kind of the future trend of where we're going with red tide testing. And Bigelow is kind of at the forefront of it. So, that's Maine red tide. Any questions? Sure. Oh. Yes.
How toxic are the cysts compared to the living cells?
How toxic are the cysts compared to the living cells? They are toxic, but they're not readily grazed. In the bottom, in the benthos, so it's not really an issue, whereas the cells in the water column are grazed by shellfish primarily. So it's the cells in the water column we're really concerned about when we monitor. But yes, they are toxic.
More so or less so?
It's a guess, but I'd say less so. We're less concerned about the cysts than we are about the cells in the water column, put it that way. Got a question back there?
How long does a cyst survive?
It depends on the species. There's some red tides off Europe where they've cored 5,000 years down and found cysts that they've existed. So 5,000 years. They've also cored deeper and done a history of red tides in those areas. Here, they've kept them in freezers, not at Bigelow, at Bowie for 10 to 20 years and still managed to exist. Cells have hatched out of them. So these are cysts are very sturdy cells. They're meant to survive adverse conditions, and that's what they do. And once you have cysts in your area, you pretty much have red tide.
Yeah, swimming.
Swimming, you're fine.
Fine.
Concentrations are never that high. Alexandria was not really known for contact issues with skin. I wouldn't swim with your mouth open. But and you probably won't even know it's there because the concentrations are so low, except it's bioluminescent. If the water sparkles around you, it's a possibility it's there. It has the same reaction as fireflies have.
Is all bioluminescence toxic?
No, not at all. It's just a quirk of some of these species that they are bioluminescent. We don't know why. It could be keep the grazers away, Could be to attract grazers to eat your competitors. There's a variety of theories about it.
If you look closely, do you see a difference in this kind versus that kind of bioluminescence?
Do you see differences in the kinds of bioluminescence? It's the same chemical reaction, luciferin luciferase, that you find in fireflies. So it's the same chemical reaction versus fireflies versus single-celled algae in the ocean.
Speaking of bioluminescence, I recall once reading that the ancient Indian tribes, before they would have a shellfish feast, would send a ray down to the water to swish the paddle around, and if it bioluminesced, they would not have the shellfish feast. Is that true?
Well, there's a lot of rumors. There's also a rumor that the Indians didn't like the settlers and said, go out and eat shellfish in June. That's a little bit of biocontrol going on right there. Yeah, there's a lot of early stories that a lot of the natives knew there were seasons where you did not consume shellfish. Didn't know why, but they knew it was not good.
Are there cysts in the main waters that date back before that 1972 date? That's right.
There probably are. I mean, when they are there cysts that date back before 92? 72, sorry, excuse me. I don't think so. When they map these cysts, they usually do the top 0 to 3 centimeters and then 3 to 6 centimeters. And they don't grow much deeper than that. So I don't know if there's a historically. Most of the reports of red tide have been from Canada and the Bay of Fundy, not Maine, prior to the big storm of 72. So I can't say definitively yes or no, but I suspect no. One more question?
How localized are the blooms? Can you have one river mouth free of it and then another one right around the island? Okay.
How localized are these blooms? Can an area be free and not? Very localized in some cases. These are very small cells that are very subject to currents. So you can have currents concentrating them in one area and not in another. And that can be problematic because there was one year when they closed just about most of the main coast except for a little spot near Arcadia. And the scientists up there were pleading with them to close that little spot because they knew the one open spot was going to get heavily fished. And they essentially, yes, it was the only open spot. They came and took all the clams, all the oysters, mussels out of that one little spot because it was the only open area. But yeah, it's variable. I live on Southport, and there's years where the closure line is down the middle of Southport. I can eat mussels on the west side, but not on the east side at my mother's place. Not that I'd eat them on either side, but yeah, it is highly localized. As I said, they're microorganisms. They depend upon the currents and how the currents move them around and how it concentrates them. They're also phototactic, so you're going to find them in the surface. They're attracted to light during the day, so they're going to want to swim up too. So it's the surface currents that are probably the most important thing. Okay, on to cyanohabs. What is a cyanohab? It's a bloom of cyanobacteria. These used to be called blue-green algae because they look kind of bluey-green, but they're not algae. They're not a dinoflagellate like the red tide in Maine or Florida. These are actually prokaryotes. They don't have organized organelles. They are photosynthetic, though. They have chlorophyll A. Vary in size from 0.4 to 60 microns. Some of these are so large you can see them. Literally, you can see pond scum. Some you can see the filaments. They have quirks. Some of them actually fix nitrogen gas. They're not dependent on fertilizer or a nitrogen source. They actually have enzymes that can use to fix that nitrogen gas out of the air. Convert it to ammonia and use that for nutrition.
How?
Why do we care about these things? Well, they produce a wide, they're very old evolutionarily, and they produce a wide range of bioactive compounds. And these can be hepatotoxin, affect the liver, neurotoxin, or cytotoxin, or even just cause allergies, believe it or not. So they produce a whole suite of toxins that are a concern from a health standpoint. One worry, why do we care about these? There's always been pond scum, right?
No.
Well, in different systems, there's always been pond scum. This is data from NOAA from Lake Erie, and this is one of the reasons we're very concerned about them. If you look at 2003, bloom severity index 4 versus 13, 15, there's a trend there, and it's increasing. This is reflected in other systems. I just showed you one example. But we're seeing an increase in these cyanohexanes globally. So there's more of them. Why worry? Well, I mentioned there are health risks. If you look at marine systems and main red tide, for example, up here, marine, there's your red tide. How are you affected? Well, you can consume the clams that consume the algae, or in some limited cases, like Florida red tide, you can actually inhale the toxins at the beach. When the cells get in the surf and break up, they're injected into the aerosol, and you're actually, we call it the red tide tickle, you're actually breathing in the toxins. So those are the two main methods you can be affected by a marine red tide. Maine, it's largely the consumption here. Freshwater is a lot more diverse. We don't necessarily eat freshwater shellfish. They have in Florida, I was talking to the head of the department that actually closes the shellfish beds, and people were asking him and says, well, what do you do if somebody eats shellfish from fresh water? And he said, well, he's going to be very sick and in the hospital. What do you do? How do you cure him? He said, well, first of all, I go arrest them. It's illegal. You know, and then we treat them. So mostly treat them. So he was more concerned about the fact that it's illegal. You're not supposed to consume shellfish from fresh water. So that's a big X. But you can ingest these blooms. And how you ingest them is drinking water. These freshwater sources, a lot of them, particularly in Florida, the rivers I'm talking about, are sources of drinking water. So if that's one way to get the toxins, you can inhale them. You can get them via kidney dialysis, believe it. That's rare, but there was one instance in South America where there was a kidney dialysis center. They took the water directly from a lake, and they didn't know that it had a cyano bloom. 45 people died. There's poor people getting kidney dialysis, and they did not know, the people running it, that there was a cyanotoxin bloom going on at the time. So they essentially died of toxin poisoning. This is, since that incident, that's very well monitored, and it hopefully will never happen again. But there's also an issue with contact. Some of these things cause allergens, and I'll show you an example in a minute. So with these cyanohabs, they're a little more complex in terms of how they can affect you than the marine ones. Well, why worry? Drinking water, I mentioned. Remember 2 years ago, the city of Toledo had its drinking water shut down. 500,000 people did not have drinking water out of their tap. What happened is they're right on Lake Erie, and there was a microcystis bloom that basically encroached upon the intake pipes for their freshwater system. And the toxin came into the system. The problem is they detected the toxin, but at the time, the EPA, who regulates these toxins, did not have guidelines for the amount of toxin that is harmful to a human. There were World Health levels. World Health Organization has recommendations, and Australia does. But the US did not. And it's kind of a quirk. I'll explain in a minute. Why is it of concern? Well, the EPA did issue bulletins. And I should have emphasized in the bottom, but it said the primary toxic effect of this toxin is irreversible damage to the liver. That's not something you want to hear about your drinking water, basically. And they didn't filter this message, so a lot of people were very upset. Well, what's the issue? Why aren't there health advisories? Marine red tides are managed at the state level, and they're overseen, too, in terms of the research, by NOAA. NOAA does work with the Great Lakes. But the variety of these cyanohabs fall under the EPA regulations. And to be very specific, they fall under the drinking water regulations of the Safe Drinking Water Act. And this act lists cyanobacterial and toxins as a contaminate list. Ambient waters, pond scum, fall under the Clean Water Act. So if you see a bloom, it falls under the Clean Water Act. If you drink that bloom, it falls under the Safe Drinking Water Act of the EPA. And the EPA really dropped the ball on this, to be perfectly blunt. I hope there's nobody working for the EPA in the audience, because I am sort of subcontracted by them right now. But they did not have what's called a health advisory. These basically describe the contaminant concentration in which health impacts occur over a specific period. And they had to send people to the World Health Organization and the Australia guidelines. Well, it was such a wake-up call to the EPA that within a year, they did publish guidelines for several of the toxins, which I've listed here. The problem is this 0.3 is the limits of detection for the method commonly used by drinking water facilities. So there's a little bit of an issue in that your lowest value is your limit of detection in your methods. So they're still dealing with issues with this. This is only for drinking. They don't have advisories for inhalation yet or contact. And that's, we're actually working with a subcontractor of the EPA on this right now. So it's a work in progress, but Toledo was a wake-up call for a lot of scientists and government agencies that these blooms are a concern and they're affecting human health. Another reason to worry, I mentioned aerosolization. This is something I dealt with in Florida for a long time. Cells get into the surf, they break up, and you get aerosolized, the sea spray. The toxins get injected into that, and you're actually breathing in very 10 to the minus 9 micromolar concentrations of toxins. And the winds blow these aerosols up to 3 miles inland. Mm-hmm. So we call it the red tide tickle, and the tourists will say, why am I catching a cold? You know, no, there's a red tide right there. There are other species where it happens too. We're starting to see blooms in the Mediterranean of a different dinoflagellate. Just put people in the hospital. But it's a concern with cyanobacteria because we don't have the health advisories. We have no idea what the concentrations are harmful. But we do know that some of these toxins can be inhaled. There's been studies that looked at jet skiers in a lake that were jet skiing in a cyano bloom and actually found the cells in their nasal passages. So people do inhale these toxins. As I said, there's very little data. We're starting to suspect, and I'll get into this in a moment, links with neurological diseases like ALS. And that's kind of where the concern, I don't want to freak out too much, but this is a concern for scientists right now. And I'll show you a little bit of the data. And there's also many coincident issues that make this a hard subject to study. Some of these cells are really hard to ID. They don't have a lot of morphological characteristics. A single species can be toxic or non-toxic, but you don't know which. It's hard to measure the toxins. And we have new toxins we're dealing with. I just wanted to have one data slide in here. One of the research I'm doing is looking at ways to mitigate aerosol of red tide, aerosolization. How do you reduce it? And I'm also interested in dissolved organic carbon, humics and tannins, which are the brown stuff in fresh water. Those are degraded products of terrestrial plants as they decay. Turns out those compounds change the surface tension of the water enough that you reduce aerosolization. So it may be, the first rule of red tide mitigation is do no harm. However you're curing a red tide, don't make it worse. So we're looking at ways that we can introduce this natural DOC, possibly to reduce aerosols at a local level. So we are doing research on this. Another reason we're worried about cyanos, I'll talk fast because I don't want to come to the end, contact issues. People are allergic. This is Lingvia majuscula. It is actually a marine subtropical cyanobacterial. And it causes contact dermatitis. It has toxins. And if you don't know what contact dermatitis is, that's contact dermatitis right there. It's a nasty little bird. It's kind of slimy. It is a concern because it chokes out natural seagrasses too. This is sort of what it looks like under a microscope. It also is responsible for asthma symptoms, eye irritation. It blooms as far north as Cape Cod. Here in Maine, so far, we don't have to be concerned with it. So contact is an issue. The other thing to worry about is other toxins, I mentioned briefly. There is a new toxin on the radar called EMAA, short for methylaminoalanine. This is produced by cyanobacteria in freshwater, estuarine, and marine systems. It only came on the radar about 5 or 6 years ago. The work, and I'll show you in a minute, of Paul Cox, an ethnobiologist. It's found in the brain, autopsy brain tissue of ALS patients from both Miami and Guam. And it's suspecting that this particular cyanotoxin may have a link with neurological diseases. It is not a causation link at the moment, it's more of a correlation link. Why do we think this? This isn't my work, this is the work of an ethnobiologist called Paul Cox out west, and he studied the Chamorro people of Guam. And it's a native speak people. They have an ALS, a Lou Gehrig's disease rate, that is 100 times normal populations. Their culture is prone to this disease. It runs through families. It's tragic. And what he did is start to study. He suspected that there was a dietary issue here. They were getting, it wasn't just hereditary, I think the numbers are 10 to 15% of ALS is hereditary. So there are environmental triggers out there. We don't know what they are. He suspected that they had to do with cyanobacteria. And he looked at the diets, and he looked at the native diet. And what the staple is the seeds of these palm trees. But the A, they're toxic, and they're toxic because there are cyanobacteria in these trees and grow. So when you harvest the seeds and grind them into flour, you're actually grinding the toxins too. And while they, the BMAA, and while they would wash them, there's still enough toxin that it was measurable in their diets. The other thing is this particular native species consumed flying foxes. It was a delicacy. Flying foxes consume the seeds of these trees. So these native people were getting a double hit in their diet. They were getting toxins from the seeds, toxins from the flying foxes, a huge dietary toxin load. Some of the evidence, well, flying foxes are now extinct, and their extinction correlates with a decrease in the incidence of ALS in these populations. The BMAA was found in the seeds, in the foxes, and in the humans. And recently, it's been related to brain lesions. So we're fairly sure there's a link here. And as soon as the natives got away from consuming these seeds, the incidence of ALS went down. So while it's a concern, there were huge amounts of toxins that were moving and concentrated in the food chain that they were consuming. Now the question is, what are the impacts of chronic exposure to very low concentrations? If you're living on a Pawtucket Lake, do you need to be worried? You're not consuming those toxins. You may be inhaling them, but at a very, very, very low concentration. So this is a particular case with unique circumstances. And it's a very, very elegant piece of research. Other evidence, I mentioned the Guam case. There seems to be a cluster of neurological diseases around Gulf War veterans from the first Gulf War. How is that related to cyanobacteria? Well, there are cyanobacteria blooms in the Gulf. And with the heat, they desiccate. And when they desiccate, they blow up into the air, aerosolize. So one of the hypotheses is there was people breathing in these desiccated toxins. There was also a case, I won't talk about in depth, a paper came out. There is a lake in New Hampshire that seems to have a cluster of ALS around it. And this particular lake is prone to cyanobacterial blooms. And you may have seen this on the news in the past year. I need to qualify that. Correlation is not causation. So the fact that these correlate disease with a cyanobacterial bloom doesn't mean it's the cause. It may be one of the mitigating factors. There are genetics, there are other environmental factors, there are other, I think, dietary factors that probably play a role. But this is kind of where the state of the research is right now. There is a lot of concern about these blooms. One last piece of evidence, BMAA in the environment. There's been issues with measuring it with techniques, but I just listed a study in Florida. You can see that they found a lot of things were not detected in fish, barracuda, but they found it in oysters, they found it in pink shrimp, in marine environments. We don't know the levels to be concerned about this. Yes?
Are you able to name the lake in New Hampshire? And the next question follow-up is, can it spread from lake to lake? What is the dynamic there?
I have the lake on my computer. I can look it up later. I wasn't familiar with it.
In terms of spreading?
The blooms can. They tend to colonize a lake. If you've got the particular bloom, you'll have it the next year, essentially. They have not resting cysts, but life cycle stages that are resistant that overwinter. As to whether they spread, it's harder to spread fresh water. I mean, if you take a bucket of water and move it from one lake to another, you're going to spread it. If you take your boat from one lake to another, there's a possibility you're going to spread it. If they're close, you know, a good storm may spread the aerosols. So yes, there is potential for spreading. And I can give you the name of that lake later. Okay. So, should you be concerned? That's the bottom line. Seafood, this is what I always tell people from commercial outlets, fish markets, grocery stores, etc., is safe to eat. You're fine. Don't worry at all about that. If you go collect your own seafood from your front yard, be sure to check your local DMR or whatever your state equivalent is first for closures. Most of the cases of red tide toxin poisoning in Maine are fishermen offshore that don't check and just have clam fest, or tourists who don't know about red tide, and that's an issue in Florida, who rent a condo and say, I rented this condo for X dollars, I'm gonna eat this shellfish, and they get very, very sick. Or non-native speakers too, who don't see the warning. So we still get incidences of poisonings, but they're very rare. Cyanobacteria, what can we say about them? Be aware of blooms. Don't go jet skiing in a pond scum, I should say. Qualify that, I've seen people do that in Florida. So, and limit your exposure to HABs. As I said, correlation is not causation, but there's enough data that makes us worried, and it's a subject of study right now. So I thought I'd conclude by bringing back to Bigelow's mission statement. If you're not aware of it, it's basically to investigate the microbial drivers of global ocean processes through basic and applied research, education, and enterprise. And HAB science is kind of all woven through this. We do basic research, but a lot of the research with HABs is applied. We want to know, for example, controlling aerosolization. How do we do that so that for the common good to reduce exposure? How do we make these blooms less toxic? How do we manage them better so that people aren't impacted? So we're doing very applied research. Here at Bigelow, there's a variety of different things. Some of these are mine. Some of these are actually other scientists here. We do collaborate with DMR, shellfishermen, and shellfishermen for toxin analysis. We're also, next month, holding a HAB taxonomy 10-day class for state managers from as far away as Alaska and Hawaii are coming here to learn how to look through a microscope and say, that's Alexandria, which, believe it or not, is a lost art with molecular, all the molecular work going on. And our taxonomists are getting older. So we saw a need and got this funded by NOAA. So we're going to be educating the managers as to what they're looking at. In particular, my research, we're looking at climate changes on Alexandrian nutrient cycling. This is my intern, Alexandrium, in the back. She wants to raise her hand. Not Alexandria, Tatiana, excuse me. That was a horrible story. Tatiana from Puerto Rico studying Alexandria. We're looking at a species called Pseudonitzia. It's a toxic diatom. It's a huge problem off the West Coast. We have it, but it's not a problem here. And we're interested in why, and is it going to be a problem? I look at ways to mitigate aerosolization, and also I'm working on developing these health risk advisories for cyanobacteria. And the last slide I want to put up is just a little bit of PR for Bigelow. Has a new venture, the Center for Venture Research on Seafood Safety. I mentioned that HAB research is very applied. Well, a lot of the science we do is for science sake, but not all of it, and probably not the majority of it. We want to do science that is beneficial to society. Science that meets the needs of industry through science-based solutions, meets the needs through management for informed policy, and science that also meets the needs of the public awareness and education. So our new Center for Seafood Security has these goals, and it's a brand new venture. Just starting out, I encourage you to grab a bulletin from the front table and read up on it. So bottom line is HAB research is very management-oriented, very applied. And I think I'll end it there and take any questions you've got. Let's see. I apologize for going over. The orange shirt?
If I had two questions. One is, given the history of it, I would imagine that there's some benefit that these apps form or serve some benefit environmentally or changing the lives.
What are the benefits to being toxic, you mean? Well, there are some benefits they're discovering. The Florida red tide, they discovered a compound in cultures called Brevinol, which is actually going to be a treatment for cystic fibrosis, believe it or not. So, and that was developed through research on Brevitoxin, the toxins. There seemed to be an antitoxin they discovered, and they're getting it patented for, as I said, cystic fibrosis treatment. As to why the organisms are toxic, there's a whole lot of theories. It could be defense. Some zooplankton don't want to eat a toxic organism. They'll spit it right back up again. It could be just a byproduct of the biochemistry of the cell. The main red tide, the toxin, saxitoxin, has a lot of nitrogen. And some people say it's storing the nitrogen. So it's not producing it to be toxic, it's producing it to store nitrogen for it to enable the cell to live. So there's a whole variety of theories.
And my other question was whether there's anything that you're doing is in a race to, that would be responsible for that increase that you showed us.
What's responsible for that increase?
Yeah, what human impact?
It depends on the particular red tide. And I said they're not all equal. Florida has always had red tides. Maine had it with the storm. This possibly making them more temperature changes, increases, or making them more severe in terms of toxicity. Freshwater blooms, it's probably increasing temperature, changing global climate is probably playing an impact. I left out the last one, though. It's probably what we call eutrophication, nutrient enrichment. The reason for those cyanohabs is temperature, but it's probably nutrient enrichment largely from agriculture.
Thank you.
Yeah, being an Ohio native and being from the Cleveland area worrying about the Toledo bloom moving down,
yeah,
down lake, I've talked to a number of scientists that have studied the phenomenon. They really are looking at the poor agricultural practices. When they drain the Black Swamp in the Toledo area, they put in quick draining tiles rather than slow draining tiles, mm-hmm, so that the nutrients, the over eutrophication, you know, the too much fertilizer in the farmer's fields are draining off very quickly. But those tiles were put in many, many years ago. Is the combination of that poor agricultural practice and the increased climate, the increased temperature, is that what is causing
The causes over the long term? It's probably synergistic. It's probably temperature. These blooms like nothing more than light and warm air. It's probably the nutrient practices that have been ongoing out west for 100 years, essentially. It all makes their way downstream into these freshwater bodies. They're not nitrogen limited. A lot of these can fix nitrogen, so it's primarily phosphorus that we're concerned about. In marine systems, it's nitrogen, but in freshwater, it's phosphorus.
The spit of containing toxins like oysters and clams and whatnot, does cooking do away with that thoroughly?
Does cooking do away with toxins in shellfish? No. And that's a problem. A lot of people cook it up and say, oh, I'm going to boil it. No. You know, toxins are gone. They're not. Cooking doesn't impact that. So that's a concern.
What are the treatments? For people who are affected, if you say they're in the hospital, what are the treatments?
It depends on the particular type of toxin. With paralytic shellfish poison, saxitoxin, it essentially stops your heart and lungs. So they used to put them on like their lung and artificial means of breathing and keeping the heart going. In Florida, Florida red tides have never killed anybody, but it's a GI issue. It's a neurotoxin. The curious thing about it is, you know you have it, it reverses your sense of heat and cold. So you know you've consumed a bad shellfish in Florida when you can touch an ice cube and it feels like you're touching fire. It's very, very characteristic, and that's how one of the ways they got this here.
I grew up in Detroit. We used to sail into Lake Erie in the 60s, and it was very green. And then there was some awareness and whatever, and there was a period where it seemed to clear up. Lake Erie looked pretty good, and I was surprised when all this thing came up in
The detergent laws. They pulled phosphorus out of detergents. The government
and
said
that
you cannot clean it up for a long time. And now we're at the point where we've dealt with, that's cleaned it up as much as it could. And now we're dealing with the agricultural practices. So a lot of that recovery you're talking about is real, and it's related to the law that essentially EPA passed that took phosphate out of detergents.
You talked about blue-green algae and said it's really prokaryotes. But there's blue-green algae that's sold as a health supplement on lakes in Oregon and other places. Is that the same thing?
Yep. The main one sold is called Spirulina.
You were quite that
late. She asked, there are nutritional supplements sold that are advertised as cyanobacteria or blue-green algae. Are they a problem? That's being investigated. They found some of these toxins in some of these supplements. That being said, the supplement industry is not very regulated at all. So just about anybody can go and grow it up, concentrate it, and make a pill and sell it on the web. I can cite you a study or two that has looked at the toxin content in these pills and found some of these toxins. I don't eat them. And I don't eat raw shellfish either. I do eat raw shellfish. Yes?
With regard to the drinking water issue, how do you mitigate the effects? Like the Toledo thing, what happened? How did they make it safe again?
They shut down the intakes, basically. Clean the system and waited for the bloom to go away. Toxin levels, they monitored the toxins levels and they went down in the system.
So they didn't do anything, they just waited for it to naturally clear?
Essentially. There are some things you can do. There's some flocculants and things that actually take the algae cells out of the system. You saw the pictures of Lake Okeechobee, I showed the green. There are flocculants you can add that will take that to the bottom. The problem is the toxins are not just in the cells, they're dissolved. These cells break up and die, the toxins don't just go away, they're in the water. So when you mitigate these, you have to mitigate the cells and the dissolved toxins. And that's what the problem is. You need a good method that gets rid of both. And the only method I've seen actually with the Florida Red Tide that does that is ozonation. If you hit it with ozone, the problem is that's hugely expensive. You can do a little piece of water, but to do a whole beach, you do half the Gulf of Mexico, but you can't do it.
Take one more.
I think I might have exhausted them.
In that case, I'm going to thank Cindy on behalf of all of us. I think she's brought a real perspective from her international work in Florida and now in Maine. And I think we're very, very privileged to have Cindy amongst us and giving us some of the insights into the new work that's going on. Thank you very much.